Some say the trouble's in the Pentagon. Some say the trouble's in the street. Some say the president's a paragon. Where's the trouble at the bottom?
Hi, I'm Steve Pleich, and I'll be your host for this segment on human rights here now. On this program, we'll be talking about the establishment of a Constitution Protection Zone in both the city and the county of Santa Cruz. I'm really delighted to have with me today two of the people who are in the forefront of this movement in the city and county. Daniel Sheehan. Daniel, welcome. Daniel is legal counsel for the Romero Institute. And Sara Nelson, executive director of the Romero Institute. Formerly, I would hasten to say, the Christic Institute, so just
That's right.
People know. Daniel, let's start with you. Certainly people in Santa Cruz are familiar with your national reputation as an advocate and as legal counsel, most notably with the Lakota People's Law Project and recently with the Ohlone Elders, which you were good enough to champion in their recent ancestral burial grounds dispute with the developers. Tell us a little bit about your background, just so the people can familiarize yourself with you.
Actually, we spent almost 20 years in Washington, D.C., Sara and I, directing the Christic Institute, which is a major 501c3 public interest law firm and in organizing organization that really tended to represent the 54 major religious denominations in the country, their social ministry offices. That prior to that time, Sara, who was our executive director, was the National Labor Secretary for the National Organization for Women in Washington, D.C. I was chief counsel for the Jesuit National Headquarters. I'd graduated from Harvard Law School and was the co-founder of the Harvard Civil Rights Law Review and went on to Wall Street and practiced at the Cahill firm, the number one corporate litigation law firm. We represented the New York Times in the Pentagon Papers case. We actually prepared the briefs and argued in the court all the way to the Supreme Court. To allow the New York Times to publish the 47 volumes of the Pentagon Papers. I actually initiated the litigation that established the right of journalists to protect their confidential news sources. And so I spent that time there, then went to F. Lee Bailey's office and was legal counsel, and our office represented James McCord in the Watergate burglary case, and he's the guy that blew the whistle
of course,
on Richard Nixon, wrote the letter to Judge Sirica blowing the whistle on them. And then I went back to Divinity School, Harvard Divinity School, and then went on to become chief counsel for the United States Jesuit headquarters. And
that's
where Sara and I worked together on the Silkwood case. Sara initiated the Karen Silkwood case and came and brought me on as legal counsel. And we did that case. We did the Three Mile Island litigation in Pennsylvania. We did the prosecution, the civil rights prosecution against the Ku Klux Klan and the American Nazi Party down in Greensboro, North Carolina. And we did the American Sanctuary Movement cases down in Texas that declared unconstitutional the refusal to enforce the act that gives refugee status to bona fide refugees. And we did the major Iran-Contra case.
Okay.
We're the ones that initiated the Iran-Contra case and pushed and forced to get the special prosecutor brought on board. So those are the things that we have done in Washington, D.C. And then we came to California and have been here since then and have been working for the State of the World Forum. Sara was the executive director for the Gorbachev Foundation and the State of the World Forum that was co-founded by Gorbachev and former American Secretary of State James Baker, bringing in world presidents at the end of the Cold War. Trying to work with presidents and secretaries of state and secretaries of defense and heads of the major corporations around the world to try to establish some new paradigm prior to the bad guys figuring out some other bad guys to make a new Cold War. So that's been our background, and we moved to Santa Cruz. Our younger son was going to University of Santa Cruz. And so we came here and have established the Romero Institute here and have become involved in a number of issues locally, as well as the work we're doing for the Lakota up in South Dakota. And Sara was one of the major people working to stop the spraying of the moth, brown moths here. So we've been active in this, but this issue of the the passage of the National Defense Authorization Act.
And we'll get to that.
Is scary. Yeah,
absolutely.
And so this is a huge thing for our community. Yeah.
And Santa Cruz is certainly fortunate to have a man of your ability and your experience, not only here working with us, but also through the Romero Institute. So we appreciate all that you are contributing to these very important issues. Sara, give us a little bit about your background. You're executive director of the Romero Institute, as Danny mentioned, with the Christic Institute formerly. Just tell us a bit about yourself.
Well, I think our work together really began with the Karen Silkwood case. And I had worked in Santa Cruz earlier in community access television productions, which preceded this. Yes, we were working with the cable station, and we were doing news three nights a week, and also nine programs on seniors, nine programs on women. Mm-hmm. This was in the early 70s. And then it was really one of those programs. It was a woman from Santa Cruz paid for me to go to Chicago to the Coalition of Labor Union Women's first meeting that they ever had, where they were going to talk about their needs and problems as women inside of labor unions. And it was, of course, during the, you know, really a lot of organizing in the feminist movement. And this was just the first time that the labor union women had really come forward as a group. And so it was a very big deal. And she sent me to Chicago, and I took a camera, and you know, and they were big, heavy things. I was lifting weights for 3 months before I went, so I could carry everything. And I shot the conference and did capture the spirit of the whole thing. They thought they were going to have, you know, 1,200 people. They had 3,400 people. It was just people came out of the woodwork. It was very bare, and they formed the Coalition of Labor Union Women. I took that video, and I was trying to raise money to convert it to a film, because at that time in the early 70s, not everyone had video machines.
Mm-hmm.
It was still film, and so we wanted to make an organizing tool for women in the labor movement. Mm-hmm. And through that process, and I won't go into all the details, but through that process, we showed that video up and down the East Coast, and including to the National Organization for Women, their national offices on the East Coast. And a letter came in the mail asking if I would become the labor chair for now. Mm-hmm. And I knew that it was something. I was kind of like jumping off a cliff.
Of course,
But I felt I could tell this was something that was very important to do. So I did, and we were working on, I don't know, we had a big committee, and we were working on a number of different issues. When about 7 months into it, a woman came and said, you know, I have a lot of information on someone called Karen Silkwood, and I want to give it to you, because she was a union woman. Mm-hmm. And she's dead, and I believe she was murdered, and it's a cover-up, and unless we all do something about it, nothing's going to happen. And that was the beginning of what became a very big
case. Of course,
case.
Yes. Yeah.
And what's important, I think, about that in relation to what we need to do in Santa Cruz, mm-hmm. is that was the beginning of our working with large constituencies. We had seven constituencies working on Silkwood, mm-hmm. national constituencies. The ACLU, mm-hmm. in terms of, because there were civil liberties violations.
Of course.
The Environmental Policy mm-hmm. Institute, the whole anti-nuclear movement, the National Organization for Women, the Oil, Chemical, and Atomic mm-hmm. Workers Union. There were all these national constituencies working together. And that, ever since then, we try to do that with any of the major projects. Mm-hmm. And the constituencies may change depending on what the issues are that are in one of these projects. So in this particular case, in this issue of we need a constitutional protection zone in our county and our city, one of the constituencies that's really important are attorneys.
Of course.
Because this is a legal mm-hmm. issue, a constitutional question. Yeah. This is the kind of thing that attorneys need to lead the way and mm-hmm. help people understand and articulate why we have to take action. Yeah. And I think churches are another very,
of
very
course,
important
yeah.
constituency, because the Constitution is inspired mm-hmm. in this country. We're talking about inalienable rights, which you have simply because you're born human. Where do they come from? They aren't given to us by ourselves. We are born with them. So there's a very sort of spiritual aspect mm-hmm. to the constitution in this country and its sort of inspired right. Life here and in other places. Of course, we know it wasn't perfect, right. and we've had to add more constituencies, and we need to keep adding constituencies. But it was a beautiful idea. It was a real gift that we have to offer the world amidst some of our other things
and
that we may not be so proud of.
See what we can do to preserve that. No wonder you're so comfortable here on the set as a CTV community television veteran. You know, I had the great pleasure of working with the Romero Institute folks and yourselves during this the Chris Hedges event, where you brought Christopher Hedges, to town. He was talking about defending our civil liberties, and really became a platform and a jumping-off point for what we're about to discuss, and that is the establishment of the Constitutional Protection Zone. But let's go back a little bit into the history, and Danny, you can help us with this. The NDAA, the National Defense Authorization Act, and this is kind of the bedrock. Threat, really, that we're facing,
right.
On which I think the Constitutional Protection Zone really finds some life. And
that's right.
Yeah.
That's right. Well, what happened is, obviously, after 9/11, with the passage of the Patriot Act and the other kind of rather draconian measures that were taken by the W. Bush administration and Dick Cheney, specifically, they began to move a lot of these statutes into place. But they began a whole series of executive orders, secret executive orders, that were being put in place to authorize renditioning people, mm-hmm. picking people up with no probable cause, torturing them, mm-hmm. et cetera. There were a whole series of these secret executive orders. And what happened is that John Yoo, one of the lawyers that worked with Cheney in that case, with David Addington, they began to make arguments that if these secret policies were being followed by the executive branch, and they were notifying Congress confidentially that these were going on, that they were acquiescing, that Congress was acquiescing to what it is they were doing. And so they continued to make that argument throughout their entire administration. And when people started finding out about these things, the American Civil Liberties Union being one of the leading groups, I did all the litigation for the American Civil Liberties Union for 10 states.
Well, thank you on behalf of the ACLU.
Yeah.
I'm vice chair of Santa Cruz County ACLU, so we appreciate your efforts.
So the ACLU was one of the leading people on this, and so a lot of us started looking to ACLU to kind of help bring forth what the challenges were to these things, mm-hmm. and ACLU began to find out about these secret programs, started trying to challenge them in courts, and what happened is that the progressive elements and liberal elements in the Democratic Party started mobilizing to try to oppose these things. And that's why Obama, when he was running for the presidential nomination, and John Edwards, too, began to talk about these things and began to challenge these things, saying that if they were elected, that they would stop these things. Mm-hmm. And what happened is Obama came to office based on a lot of his opposition to these things that had been challenged. But what happened is once he got into office, he was surrounded by these national security state types, and he began to acquiesce to the continuation of these things. So there was a movement that was begun in Congress through some of the Progressive Caucus, for example, to try to raise potential legislation to challenge some of these things. And what happened is the right-wing elements in the Republican Party mirror to that said, look, let's try to get these codified. Mm-hmm. Let's try to get these specifically authorized by legislation and so that we can basically push back against the liberals in the Democratic Party and challenge them for being soft on terrorism. And what happened is this sort of came to the fore here in 2011. What happened is the extreme right-wing elements in the House of Representatives proposed a couple of insertions into the big, huge omnibus military authorization bill. They said, look it, if we can slip these into the military authorization bill, anybody who votes against it is going to look like they're soft on supporting the military. Right. And the liberals in the Democratic Party are very sensitive about that. So they devised this tactic. And those of us in the ACLU started talking about, look, this is that extreme right-wing element. it's not likely that the general people in the Republican Party, the mere conservatives and moderates, are going to go along with this. But what happened is, because of the coercive power of that extreme right-wing element within the Republican Party, they first cowed the conservatives, and then they cowed the moderates, and so they ended up kind of as a block supporting inserting into this National Defense Authorization Bill as of April of 2011 these provisions, Section 1021
right.
and Section
yep.
1022. Mm-hmm. And these particular provisions were attempting to codify a series of secret procedures that had been going on in the W. Bush administration, the renditioning, mm-hmm. that is,
and
sweeping
people who may not understand
renditioning is sweeping a person off the streets
right.
Without any probable cause to believe that they've committed any specific crime. Mm-hmm. It's prospective law enforcement.
Right.
It's thinking, oh, well, this person's a potential threat. Mm-hmm. They may be engaged in something. And what they would do is they would scoop them up, and they'd say, well, because they haven't committed any crime yet, we certainly can't arraign them because we can't show there's any probable cause to believe they've committed a crime.
Conveniently dispenses with that requirement.
Dispenses with that. And of course, the issue doesn't come up about whether they're going to have legal counsel mm-hmm. Because they're not going to be charged with any crime, so
exactly.
why would they need legal
right.
counsel? And so they had a whole series of these private practices. And so what they decided they were going to do is they were going to codify these in Section 1021.
Mm-hmm.
And what they were going to do is they were going to authorize the United States military to sweep a person off the street,
mm-hmm.
even without any probable cause that they committed a crime. And so they had to articulate some standard for what would operate under this statute. So they said, any person who has been directly shown to be engaged in military combat against the United States and responsible for attacking us on 9/11. Of course, everybody goes, well, certainly.
Yes,
well, certainly
yeah.
them. And then they said, well, okay, but in addition to that, mm-hmm. we want to have anybody who is a member of the organization
right.
of the people that went and did this. And then thirdly, we'd like to have anybody included who gave any kind of support.
The supporters, and I noticed that is part of
that's right. Yeah, so they kept building larger and larger concentric
right.
circles
right,
around
exactly.
this core of terrorists
mm-hmm.
And kept expanding out the statute until they put in the statute saying, look, they wanted to authorize the military to sweep anyone off the street and rendition them and put them in prison
mm-hmm.
and hold them indefinitely
right.
with no right to counsel, no right to a trial, no right to any kind of habeas corpus, which means I insist upon being brought in front of a judge,
of course,
an
yes,
independent
indeed.
Judge,
yeah.
and have you put up your evidence to show what probable cause you have to believe that I've committed any crime.
And I recall that from law school, so thank you for the refresher course.
Which is right uh-huh. in the Constitution.
Yeah.
I mean, it says this is a critical, fundamental right of American citizens. And so that they said, look, let's just dispense with that and see if we can get away with it. And so they put this up into the statute under Section 1021.
Mm-hmm.
And then they said, a very tricky thing that they did, they said this applies to everybody. Okay, this apply to anybody, which would include American citizens, right?
Right?
And then they had, in Section 1022, they said, look, we're going to put in a provision here that says if anyone is caught directly engaged in military combat
mm-hmm.
against the United States, they absolutely have to be incarcerated in a military detention facility
mm-hmm.
as distinct from a federal prison anywhere. And because in a military facility, they can be tortured. They can be subjected to enhanced interrogation techniques and waterboarded
mm-hmm.
and sleep deprived and put into these painful positions and locked in cages
mm-hmm.
and put in entombed boxes.
And under the jurisdiction of military law rather than civil law.
That's right.
In fact,
and so that's exactly right.
Yeah.
So in Section 1022, they said, look, anybody caught in direct military combat against the United States has to be detained in a military facility
mm-hmm.
where they have access to these kind of procedures against them. And they put in that one, they said, of course, the mandatory requirement that they be incarcerated in a federal military
mm-hmm.
facility doesn't apply to Americans.
Hmm.
That's what they said, which means that they can be held in a military detention facility, but they don't have to be.
Right.
Everybody else has to be. And so it introduced this great deal of confusion in some people's minds. If Section 1022 specifically says that it doesn't necessarily apply to Americans, well, then that must apply to Section 1021 too. So that they don't have to. They don't have. But the fact of the matter is, Dianne Feinstein, our United States Senator, one of our two,
mm-hmm.
said, wait a second. It appears to me that Section 1021 that authorizes the sweeping you off the streets and incarcerating you, regardless of what kind of facility you're going to be kept in, It at least authorizes you to be held in a military stockade, and this appears to apply to Americans. And I want to put in an amendment similar to what's in 102.2. I want that in 102.1 say, this doesn't apply to Americans. And Lindsey Graham stood up on the floor of the Senate from South Carolina and said, it absolutely does apply to Americans. Mm-hmm. Why wouldn't you want it to apply to Americans if they're engaged in military combat against them, or, in fact, giving support to them, or support any have done anything to support some affiliated organization that was engaged in hostilities against any ally of ours? It just, these concentric circles just kept getting bigger and bigger. And so the fact is, her amendment to try to explicitly have it not apply to Americans was defeated. And so it's clear that it applies to Americans. And so so what happened is the right wing puts it into the bill. The moderates and the conservatives first and the Republican Party fold, then the moderates fold. And then what happens is they confront the Democrats in the House of Representatives. And they say, look, well, we're going to put this bill up there, and you Democrats, if you're going to be soft on terrorism, you know, we're going to go after you, and we're going to tell all your constituents about this.
Right. So this is the problem.
No. So the moderates, first the blue dogs in the Democratic Party, say, okay, look, I've got a lot of fairly conservative people in my state, so I'll support this too, because, you know, basically it isn't going to pass anyhow, because I know that my liberal brethren and sisters in the, are going to vote against it. So what happens is the blue dogs supported it. And then all of a sudden, the liberals were the ones confronted by the challenge. And so the liberals started to cave, saying, look, we'll pass this in the House. We'll pass this in the House. In the Senate, which is under the control of the Democrats, you know, they'll figure out a procedural way not to take this thing up. And so that the House of Representatives passes it in April of 2011, right? So in May, it comes before the Senate. And what happens is now the Senate is confronted with this, and you have this whole group of blue dogs in the Senate. All of those people that were elected on the coattails of Obama back in 2008, right? They know they've got elections coming up, all right? And so they end up saying, look, we're going to support this, but we're going to rely upon the liberals in the Senate to threaten to filibuster this unless these two provisions are taken out of here. Nobody would do that. Okay, so they ended up, then they started relying upon Obama to veto it. And so, and here we are in the ACLU, we're all talking about, well, when are we going to mobilize? When are we, you know, and so we started feeling like in Germany, you know, look at, you know, they came for the Jews and I wasn't a Jew, you know, they came for the, you know, the labor union people and I wasn't a labor, or, you know, and so that finally they started mobilizing, trying to get Obama to veto this thing. And Obama takes it with him to Hawaii on vacation back in December of 2011, and he signs it at 11:30 p.m. on New Year's Eve.
Eastern time.
And so that, you know, it, right just as the ball is falling and everybody's dancing around in Times Square, he, you know, signs this thing into law so that it gets no ink at all at the time. And so what happens?
What does he say?
So he says that, look, I'm very troubled by the fact that this section 102.1 that allows you to sweep someone off the streets and incarcerate them, including
when he signs he
has a signing statement saying, look, I want to make it clear that at least I am not going to apply this against Americans, thereby making it perfectly clear that the statutory language covers American citizens. And, but he says, look, I'm a good guy. You can trust me. I'm not going to do this. But, of course, we're all saying, wait a second. What about Reagan? What about Dick Cheney? What about W. Bush? You know, that we know all these guys. What about, what Ronald Reagan?
You know, once it becomes federal law, then it's subject to the interpretation of any subsequent administration.
Well, but not only that, they knew that it applied to Americans.
Right.
It wasn't even a matter of them sort of arbitrarily interpreting it that way. It was now clear on the basis of the legislative history with Feinstein's proposed amendment and the signing statement that was made by Obama is perfectly clear that it applies to Americans. And so he just said he wasn't going to apply it against Americans. And there it was in front of us.
I mean, it was very disappointing to me because he's a constitutional attorney.
Yeah.
Of course. Yeah,
he has to know.
He knew perfectly well what the implications of this were.
I mean, I voted for him twice, but he has to have known.
So, you know, and you certainly, Sarah, are just as alarmed as Danny about the erosion of civil liberties that really presents itself through 1021, 1022. Give us your kind of observations about that.
I mean, I want to say I don't want to sound rash, because for some people who haven't thought about this yet, it may sound a little rash. But it's very clear to me that the comparison with Germany is not is not overstepping.
It's not inapt, as we say?
No, it's not.
Yeah.
Because what happened in Germany, first of all, we have a very, very active and aggressive right wing right now in our mm-hmm. country that has positions of power now, that has been, you know, doing amazing things to our House of Representatives for the last X number of years. Mm-hmm. And those of us who have been paying attention carefully to what is going on, the rise of this extreme right element mm-hmm. and the way that it boldly manipulates other sort of worldviews, whether it's the liberals or the moderates or the conservatives, always calling itself conservatives, right. wanting people to think that they are conservatives, but they're actually something different. Mm-hmm. They're extreme right. And that same element was going on in Germany. It's very bold, and people tend not to think like that themselves, and so they don't really expect certain things to happen, but mm-hmm. they do. And in fact, by the time Hitler took power, all the laws had been laid in, and he was able to pretty much legally do whatever he wanted. And what I'm saying is we're, you know, ringing the bell right now, because this particular passage of these two sections mm-hmm. is a wake-up call. We have to wake up, because this is the kind of stuff that gets laid in, mm-hmm. and if people don't do something about it, you find 5 years, 10 years from now, you're going to have all kinds of people in jail, disappearing, attorneys, not even being told what they're accused of, just disappearing into illegal.
And worse yet is that, you know, that almost immediately, the American Civil Liberties Union brought on a legal case in New York, representing Chris Hedges and Dan Ellsberg mm-hmm. and Noam Chomsky and a number of others that are pretty ardent critics mm-hmm. of American foreign policy. And they brought on a major litigation saying, look it, we have reason to believe that this could be enforced against us right. because these provisions that are put inside Section 1021 that have these growing concentric circles mm-hmm. that start out with terrorists that are attacking us, yeah, right, then the organizations of which they're just simply members, yeah. then anybody who supports those particular people, then anybody who supports any one of an affiliated organization of them, right. and if anybody who supports any group that in fact is engaged in hostilities against any ally of ours, such as, for example, Israel mm-hmm. or others, that anybody who lends support to any one of those type of organizations, it's this huge, expansive group of people. So they brought on the litigation
saying... And Christopher Hedges is a named plaintiff?
He's a named plaintiff in that, and that is Dan Ellsberg and is Noam Chomsky and the others.
So our viewers, if they have an interest in that, they want to go back and look at the precursor events, really, that
yes.
led us to where we are now, that would be something very illuminating.
Hedges versus Obama.
Okay, there you go.
You can just Google it.
Easy enough to
remember. Hedges versus Obama.
Okay, so please.
And what happened is Judge Forrest, an Obama appointee mm-hmm. to the federal court in New York, she says to the Justice Department, say, look it. These people are saying that as journalists that interview people around the world that are critical of American policy, even perhaps interviewing people in the Taliban or interviewing people in Al-Qaeda or interviewing other radical Islamists, for example, mm-hmm, mm-hmm. They're concerned that you're going to interpret this broad language of giving support to any group that's affiliated with anybody who is engaged in hostilities against the United States or any ally could possibly apply to them. Right. So they've come here asking for a declaratory judgment, declaring it to be unconstitutional mm-hmm. as applied to them, and that it's unconstitutionally overbroad and vague.
Terms with which I am ultimately familiar, so I know. Yeah.
And so what she said turned to the Justice Department, the U.S. Attorney mm-hmm. in New York, she said, just tell us on the record that this language doesn't apply to them, mm-hmm. just for simple doing journalist activities. And the U.S. Attorney said, no, I'm not going to say that.
There you have
I'm not going
right
to say
there.
That this doesn't apply to them. Mm-hmm. And so if, in fact, they were going to take the position that it doesn't apply to Americans, they could have said it just like that.
They wouldn't.
But the fact is they were insisting upon retaining the right to enforce it not only against Americans, but against American journalists. Against people who are engaged in simply interviewing anybody who's opposed to their policies, mm-hmm. and as soon as the U.S. attorney took that position, Judge Forrest declared it mm-hmm. to be unconstitutional.
She said, "Okay, that's it."
And so we said, fine, it's unconstitutional. But the Justice Department, the Obama Justice Department, you know, Holder Justice Department, immediately applied to the Second Circuit Court of Appeals and tried to get it reversed. Mm-hmm. And they took this narrow technical position of saying, look it, that these people have not proven that they've engaged in any conduct which is going to get them picked right up immediately. Mm-hmm. They're not in a clear and present immediate danger of being picked up unless they represent more details of what they're going to be doing. And so therefore, they shouldn't be granted standing to challenge this entire statute.
Right.
They should be just technically denied standing. Mm-hmm. So don't rule on the constitutionality of this. Just say that these particular people don't have standing to object to it because they haven't shown that they're in the immediate jeopardy. Right. Somebody should have said to the Court of Appeals, well, who's going to be able to show that they're going to get arrested once they've been arrested? Because they don't have any right to talk to anybody.
Right.
And they can't make any phone calls. They don't have any lawyers.
There's no habeas corpus, so they can't be brought before a court. Yeah.
So they're caught in this catch-22
that
you can't get standing until you've actually been picked up.
Right, exactly.
And once you're picked up, you can't contact anybody.
Precisely.
And so the Second Circuit Court of Appeals said, you know, basically let this cup pass away. Mm. We don't want to say it's unconstitutional. So they just backed up and said that there was no standing. So now what happened is the Santa Cruz City Council was the first one in the country to respond by saying, we're passing a resolution that Don Lane introduced it along with
Ryan Coonerty.
With Ryan Coonerty, and they introduced a resolution in our city council saying that it's our position that this is unconstitutional, and that there should be a policy that it's not going to be enforced here. That's what they said, and that we'd like to have our council contact our congressperson Sam Farr and tell him that we have a policy that we don't want this enforced here. Good. But what happened after that is the state assembly, the California State Assembly, passed Assembly Bill 351. Mm-hmm. They passed this in February of 2013, almost a full year later, after our city council had taken the lead on this, right? And the state assembly passed a bill by 71-1. Mm-hmm. In which they declared not only that this section 10-102-1 and 10-202-2 was completely unconstitutional, but that it was not to be enforced in California. And in fact, if any federal official came into our state to try to enforce either one of those provisions, they would be guilty of a crime and could be arrested by state law enforcement officials and put in jail for trying to do it. And if any state official, law enforcement officer, or any other official in the state of California participated in any way whatsoever in assisting in enforcing this against anyone, they also were guilty of a crime and would be put in jail, okay? And then they listed all of the different provisions of the United States Constitution that were violated by these two statutes. And so that's what they did, and they passed it 71-1. Mm-hmm. So anybody who's looking for political cover on this, for example, in our city council, or in our board of supervisors, they say, look at the state assembly, 71.
But when the Senate got it in the state, they took out one section, they let all of the rest of it go, and they did something much softer.
They just declared that it would be a policy. Okay. It's the policy of the government of the state of California that this not be enforced. Okay. And that no one was, they said that no law enforcement officer or other official should participate in any way. And that will be the policy. The problem is that there was no enforceability of it.
Right.
That's
it's always problem. About enforcement of legislation is one of the most important aspects of it. And
absolutely.
I want to make sure that people understand where they can go to get as much information as they would like about, as we go into our conversation about the Constitutional Protection Zone itself, SantaCruzCPZ.org, that's SantaCruzCPZ.org, and of course your own RomeroInstitute.org websites have abundant information about this. And a couple things that occurred to me as we're talking, one is that Sarah's mentioning the kind of retrogressive, reactionary state of our House of Representatives, which is about to expand itself herself into our Senate, because right. now yes. they're going to have a Senate right. majority doing the same thing. And secondarily, it troubles me that people are so woefully uninformed about this particular issue. If you talk to them about the NDAA, you talk to them about sections 1021, 1022, they just don't seem to understand any of this. And I think maybe that's one of the things that a campaign for constitutional protection can do,
that's right.
is
right.
to educate people, not only protect their rights, as we have talked about before. I am the vice chair of the ACU in Santa Cruz County, and we are concerned with the erosion, generally speaking, on the larger stage of yes. civil right. liberties in, right. in not only the nation, but also locally, because you can see that happening.
That's right.
And so as we move forward, as you move forward in passing a resolution in the city and the county for a constitutional protection zone, and let's hope that the present city council can take the same principled stand that they did with Ryan Coonerty and Don Lane,
that's right.
you know, during their era, but that's what you would be asking them to do. So talk a little bit about that campaign and kind of how you're moving forward with that.
Okay. That the main focus of this is to we would like to speak to the Bar Association, mm-hmm. The County Bar Association, to mobilize the lawyers, mm-hmm. because the lawyers are the ones that people look to try to understand these technicalities.
Right.
That, and it's very clear that the lawyers in the Congress who drafted this particular bill mm-hmm. were attempting to deceive the people. They slipped it into this huge omnibus bill mm-hmm. of funding the entire military, mm-hmm. and they just slipped it in, authorizing the military to go ahead and detain these people. And they also...
Interesting parallel, by the way, to the local legislation that the
yes.
City Council attempted to slip through uh-huh. the purchase of what is actually an urban assault vehicle, but
yes.
I digress, but let me...
Yeah, yeah.
Please,
well, yes. And also very similar to what's happening here on the national level that we just saw when this is aired last month, mm-hmm. is that the Republicans have tried to slip into the omnibus funding bill for
right.
the entire federal government.
Yeah.
Here, let's reverse some of the restrictions that have been put on banks mm-hmm. That were put on in the wake of the 2008 right. Financial crisis. Let's let them get back into selling a credit default swaps.
Well, and their high risk investments are now going to be government guaranteed.
That's right.
They're not spending risking their own money. They're risking ours.
So that's what they're trying. So
yeah.
And it's
anyway,
the same exact
please.
Tactics.
Yeah.
So that. The first thing we want to do is reach out to the lawyers. Mm-hmm. We want to talk with the lawyers in the County Bar Association to get a critical mass of our lawyers organized so that we can then, in fact, start holding meetings, so that the lawyers can hold meetings among their neighbors and friends to get each of the
of
local
course,
areas
yeah.
where each of the city council people have mm-hmm. homes mm-hmm. to move in there to conscientize them. Because we know that we shouldn't try to attack this as a vanguard change in the law. There has to be the grassroots people.
Right.
We have to all become familiar with what it is that's really going on here. And so that we want to get the lawyers brought on first. Then we want to have little town meetings mm-hmm. where the lawyers are all going around organizing and mm-hmm. telling the people that there's a serious danger. This is the Paul Revere movement.
Right.
We need to have Paul Revere saying, look at the fascists are coming, the fascists mm-hmm. are coming.
Right.
that's what we want to do. And we want to start mobilizing. We want to start getting individual people on the city council and individual people on the board of supervisors
Indeed.
Who
yes.
are going to be willing yeah. to sponsor this,
mm-hmm.
to bring this before them, and so that they know that we're coming, that we're not going to leap right on them and try mm-hmm. to make them lead the whole community on this and run the risk of being attacked for being soft on terrorism yeah. and all that. We're going to work through the grassroots, and we're going to talk to different citizens groups. Mm-hmm. We'll get the lawyers. Then what we're going to do is we'll start getting the educators. Mm-hmm. We're going to start going to the schools. We're going to go to the churches.
Yeah.
This is a grassroots campaign
of course. Yeah.
to mobilize our people, because our people have to be the ones we're the ones that are at risk here.
Mm-hmm.
They're not going to sweep in and take our city council right. members and put them in prison. They're going to come and take our right. people. and they're going to be the organizers. And
of course, in addition to yourself, there are local attorneys who are outstanding in this area. Ben Rice, for
That's
instance,
right.
Gary
mm-hmm.
Patton, for instance. Those people really could be touchstones and leaders in this
That's
kind
right.
of an effort. As Sara, in our last debrief meeting after the Chris Hedges event, which was wonderful, by the way, standing room only at Interlight Ministries. Danny, excellent introductions, and talking yourself and Sara. Chris was just extraordinary, in fact. We were talking about the ways in which you can bring networks together in order to really support
right.
The resolutions in the Constitutional Protection Zone initiative.
Yes, it was wonderful, the event at Interlight Ministries. Just, it was so wonderful. It was The whole place was, there were about 600 people there.
Yeah.
And of course, he's very inspiring speaker, very inspiring. And a lot of people organized to make that a success, Food Not Bombs and a number of other constituencies who were sponsors.
ACLU, I would say
that. ACLU, right? And lots of good people. And one of the reasons that we got involved and said that we would kind of backstop the whole thing mm-hmm. is because of the Constitutional Protection Zone project, which we'd already launched sometime before this, mm-hmm. because we really saw this event as a possibility for reaching out to people and inviting them to participate in this effort to get this a whole area to be a constitutional protection zone. The good news is 166 people signed up to work on the Constitutional Protection Zone project. And we asked them to break down their constituencies, and so they did, and so we know how many were from the religious community, how many elected leaders, how many attorneys, how many students and young people, we have those categories. We also know the kind of skills that they want to contribute. So our first meeting, which is like an organizing meeting to get organized into committees and identify our timeline and goals, is January 17th.
Okay.
And we're going to be doing that at Loudon's
Nelson
Center, and we're going to be inviting those 166 people. Now, if other people want to participate in the actual nit-grit organizing of the whole campaign. That's the day that we're going to be gathering there. It's going to be at 2:00.
And people should do this. I mean, because becoming involved in it, mm-hmm. you start to become much more educated about what is this going on.
Of course, right.
And you get to talk to your neighbors mm-hmm. to try to protect the Constitution.
Right.
And from a tactical point of view, it's important. The first thing we're going to ask the City Council and then the Board of Supervisors to do is to pass a resolution that is taking one step further along the line than they already have, that the initial resolution that they have, the problem is there's no enforcement in it. Mm-hmm. What we're gonna do is ask them to pass a resolution saying that there ought to be an actual ordinance. Mm-hmm.
And I will suggest to our viewers that SantaCruzCPZ.org, you have on that website both the city and the county resolution
that's
that
right.
they can look at themselves. One of the things that I thought was particularly encouraging for the Hedges event as kind of a launching point for me anyway to be involved in constitutional protection zone was the pre-event. We had so many of the leaders, the gatekeepers, the policymakers, those people there interested and ready to mobilize themselves and their networks into pushing this forward. And that really is very encouraging for me. I think Danny really identifies what you need to do, and this makes it a grassroots effort.
That's
right. Get out when you're talking to people about, what is the NDAA, how does it threaten your civil liberties, what can we do to protect not only my civil liberties, but my neighbor's civil liberties, my community's civil liberties, my country's civil liberties, for that matter. And this is particularly important. But tell us more about, that kind of organizing and what you really hope to accomplish.
Well, it's first what we want to do is we want to get individual people to say, look, I support a resolution like this. Mm-hmm. I support a resolution telling our city council that we want you to pass an ordinance.
Right.
So that if we can get the city council and the board of supervisors first on board agreeing to at least pass a resolution, taking one more step mm-hmm. in this direction. Mm-hmm. And then the ordinance itself, just a short 3-page ordinance, if passing the ordinance, which actually makes it enforceable. And what the ordinance is going to be doing is eventually saying, look, if in fact you're a member of an official or you're a law enforcement officer and you get wind of the fact that someone's going to try to enforce it here, as a condition of your continued employment.
Ah, interesting. There you go.
You have to
notify
the city council mm-hmm. and you have to notify the board of supervisors. Mm-hmm. And then they're required under the ordinance to immediately take steps to find the person who may mm-hmm. be the target of such an enforcement effort, not to let them go free, bring them before a magistrate here and have a full hearing with probable cause standards and represented by counsel, everything that they're entitled to.
Right.
We're not trying to set up a zone where any potential terrorist can come and get totally protected.
Right.
What we're doing is setting up a procedure where the constitutional rights are going to be provided to anybody that the federal government wants to target inside our state.
And let me say before you continue, I'd like you to continue in that vein. People will ask, Constitutional Protection Zone, what does that that look like? What does it accomplish? How is it enforced? And this is exactly what you're talking
what
about, because we can tell people that this is what it's going to do. This
That's
is
right.
how it's going to be in effect.
That's exactly right. And so it's very concrete. That if you're a deputy sheriff, for example, and you get a call, this is covered in the ordinance, mm-hmm. if you get a call from any federal military official or any federal law enforcement official or any private corporation that's working with them, such as Blackwater mm-hmm. Or anybody else, or any other state official that's working with them, and that they're indicating that they're contemplating coming into the state of California to enforce this, mm-hmm. then what you're required as a condition of your future employment mm-hmm. is to contact our city council, every one of the city council members, not just one or two, but every single one of them immediately by courier if necessary.
Wow.
Okay? Mm-hmm. And then the ordinance will mandate that that once they receive that notice, every member of the city council or state board or county board of supervisors mm-hmm. has to immediately come to the city council, mm-hmm. has to come there, and as soon as a quorum is available, they have to then move together to take steps to get that person in custody,
right.
a protective custody, mm-hmm. who is being targeted, and bring them in front of a magistrate here in our city or in our county, mm-hmm. and have that then put the federal government on notice that if they're intending to make any action taken against this person, they're to come before the court, and they're to provide whatever the evidence is that they have against that person, mm-hmm. and our magistrates will provide all of the constitutional rights to these mm-hmm. people, and that otherwise, we're going to ask the governor to move yeah. in and to establish protection for this person mm-hmm. in the same way yeah. that they did, for example, with some of the people at the Wounded Knee occupation
right.
back in 1973, Dennis Banks, who was being sought on a completely unconstitutional set of charges against him, came to California, and Jerry Brown gave him protection here. Mm-hmm. So what we're trying to do is, once we get the city of Santa Cruz on board this, mm-hmm. first with a resolution,
right.
then with the ordinance, and then the county,
mm-hmm.
then we're going to go to other cities and other counties, we're going to try to get California to become a constitutional protection zone.
Absolutely.
So yeah. that we will stand, and mm-hmm. so that the position that was originally taken mm-hmm. by the state assembly
right.
in making it a crime for any federal official to come into this state to try to enforce this is going to then be put back into the law. So that's where we're going.
That's where we're going. And you know, I think it's important that in any successful grassroots movement, there is always a point at which you want to educate people. You want to tell them exactly what this is that we're asking them to support,
that's
and
right.
how it will benefit and impact their lives. And I think that's the real benefit, again, of having a Romero Institute involved, of having yourself, a man, you know, of your caliber, your national reputation involved with something like this, to say, well, let me see, I'd take a look at this. You know, does this apply to my life? How is this going to apply to my neighbor, to my community, as I say? And to have the Romero Institute involved is really a extreme benefit to the organizational aspect of it.
Well, one thing I would like to say, again, I'd like to go back to something I was saying
Please.
Earlier,
yeah.
and that I think is so important. It certainly it's very important to us in taking this on and reaching out to other people to work with all of us together, is when you have, in our community, we have a lot of libertarian folks.
Mm-hmm.
I'm aware of that, and they've been part of our meetings. That's not the same as what I was talking about earlier, the extreme right wing.
Mm-hmm.
Because libertarian folks, they have very conservative economic views, but they have very, they support this Constitution, and they support civil liberties. And so they're a kind of a different mix in terms of their views. What I'm talking about when I say the extreme right is an element of people that I believe we've got to wake up about what's happening. You know, and for us, as people who have worked with constitutional issues for 40 years,
mm-hmm.
this is just too much to take. this NDAA yep. and this right. removal of the most important gift that we have to give the world,
mm-hmm.
Which is our the whole concept, the inspired concept of our Constitution and the Bill of Rights. And for this, when Danny lays out the history of how it became very clear that they, yes, were going to apply it to Americans, and no, they weren't going to say they weren't going to apply it to Chris Hedges and Daniel Ellsberg and Noam Chomsky, this is a clear sign that that we all have something at stake here, because this is like eating away at our most important foundations in this country.
And they're waiting for us to acquiesce to it.
Right.
Yeah, and waiting for people to just, it won't ever happen.
John Yoo, that lawyer, has actually written a book called The National Security Constitution, in which he's saying that the acquiescence on the part of the citizenry or the Congress in the face of these kind of activities can legally be interpreted as part of like a legislative history that authorizes them to go forward and do this.
Yeah.
So that they're banking on the American people not mobilizing. Mm-hmm. And then they're going to cite that to us as to why they can come and arrest your neighbor.
Well, this is the time for us. I mean, we're just kind of at that time of saying no to a fear campaign around terrorism.
Yeah.
Because that element is using this, you either do this or we're going to say you're soft on terrorism.
Yeah.
We have to stand up and say you're not going to do that to us. Mm-hmm. Because we're, you know, and then take away the civil liberties under it.
It's an appropriate time for that because in our country now, that's the language, police brutality or the things happened in Ferguson, that this stops today. And that's what you have to understand, that this stops today and today we move forward. But I think what people don't often understand is that civil liberties is not something that the government gives you. It's a personal thing.
That's
it's something that you own.
Right.
That's right.
And you have to really understand that and wake up to it before you personalize it and you're willing to do something to protect it.
That's
and
right.
I think that's what the
that's
Constitution
right.
protection
is. This is no gift from them.
No.
You know,
right.
The fact is that people that get into executive positions of power view the Constitution as an impediment. You know, the only time they encounter it is when it's being enforced against them.
Right.
And so that they're constantly trying to figure out how to get around it and how to vitiate it. And that's the first lesson you learn of the Constitution is that the reason that we've put this into writing is because every administration is going to be inclined to try to violate these particular rights.
Right.
And so it's no favor that they're doing to us.
Mm-hmm.
These belong to us. And as a sole condition for our granting to you the power that we've given to you, specific delegated powers that we the people have given those to you, you don't have any power. Mm-hmm. You have no legitimate power to be doing things that violate these fundamental rights. You're without power. Ab initio, as they say, from the very beginning, you have no such power. So when you come for us, in violation of these rights, you're no more authorized than any other person might walk off the street to try to arrest us, to take us into custody, to put us in a jail somewhere, not bring us in front of a magistrate. You are, in our state legislature, the assembly had said so, you are a criminal.
Right.
You are a criminal who's coming here to try to engage in a crime against us. We need to mobilize and we need to empower ourselves to treat them like criminals.
Yeah.
And we've got to start here in our city and in our county to do what the state assembly was willing to do, to declare those people to be criminals and to declare to be a criminal anybody who participates with them and make it clear.
The other thing is that as someone said in the organizing meeting the other day, Tatanka, who has a long history of organizing experience with Cesar Chavez and the farm workers, but he said, you know, it's important for us to really realize that we're only reaching out to people and asking them to follow the oath that they have taken when they took office.
Right.
All the people who are elected officials, the police, everybody has taken an oath to the Constitution to protect it. And so what CPZ is all about, the Constitutional Protection Zone movement is all about, is saying, okay, well, let's stand with that.
Yeah.
We are going to protect the Constitution.
Let's acknowledge that that's our duty.
Let's not engage just in platitudes.
Right.
Say, we really wish the Constitution were enforced.
Yeah.
We think it ought to be enforced. Yeah. You know, then enforce it.
Mm-hmm.
That's your job. That's your oath to protect
and again,
the Constitution.
Yeah, and again, I think that it is a very personal thing, and I think that you really have to make people aware that they may come for you. you know. And now you have to understand that they're going to come for you. And as you mentioned at the top of the show, Danny, so first they came for the lawyers, you know, and that kind of thing. When you think they're coming from somebody else, then you depersonalize it and you don't get involved. But the grassroots nature of this is to let people know that these are our rights.
It's the famous quote by Reverend Niemöller. You know, he was sitting in the prison and he said, you know,
In Germany, in 1937.
He said, you know, right out, he said, look at these statutes that were passed. First they came for the Jews, and I wasn't a Jew, I was a Christian, so I didn't do anything. Then they came for the communists, and I wasn't a communist, so I didn't do anything. Then they came for the socialists, and I wasn't a socialist, so I didn't do anything. And then they came for the labor union people. I wasn't a labor union person, you know, and then they came for the gypsies, and I wasn't a gypsy, you know, but then they came for me. And I turned and there was nobody left to help me.
There was nobody to stand for you.
There was nobody here to help me.
Yeah, exactly.
You know?
Right.
And so what I'm saying is there is, in fact, a narrow utilitarian, a self-interested argument that each an individual person can make for themselves as to why they should participate in doing this. Yeah. But there has to be also a sense of camaraderie for your fellow citizens.
Yeah, a much broader concept,
you know,
of course.
You may not be Chris Hedges, who writes books and, you know, was a Pulitzer Prize-winning journalist for the New York Times, the head of the New York Times Bureau in the Middle East, who comes before a federal court and the United States attorney says, yes, I want to reserve the right to sweep you off the street and put you in a military stockade and waterboard you, which we don't consider to be, you know, torture. You know, and you know, these people are right as we're on the air now, still going on television every day saying what they are doing is okay, and that these kind of activities they engaged in, the torture that they engaged in, you know, that those were necessary. Yeah. They're trying to rationalize it. So we still have not gotten the message through to these people, and so that we're at risk. We're at risk by these people.
And yes, their rights are no less threatened than Chris Hedges.
You know, no, that's right.
He may be standing on a stage and talking about defending our civil liberties, but there are civil liberties.
That's
right.
And they're going to run again. You know, if they run Jeb Bush, you know, I mean, how many Bushes do you have to confront on this thing? You know, to see that H.W. Bush was behind all of this stuff, the invasion into the Middle East to secure the oil fields. You know, these people are getting set to run another administration against us, you know, and that the fact of the matter is we need to make a stand that we now realize that it isn't just they that are the problem, that Obama is the problem. Hillary Clinton could be the problem. You know, we've got to stand up for ourselves and say we don't care whether it's a Republican or Democratic administration.
Right.
We're mad as hell. And we're not going to take this anymore.
And on that note, we have about 30 seconds or so. It's been wonderful having you here. You have a final comment for us, Sara, as we go out?
There's a quote by Benjamin Franklin that we had various quotes at the Chris Hedges event that were up so everyone could see them. And he said, people who will sacrifice liberty for security don't deserve either and will not have either.
Yeah.
And I think that's where we're at.
Well, people can go to the SantaCruzCPZ.org website. They can go to the Romero Institute website, RomeroInstitute.org. Danny Sheehan, Sara Nelson, thank you so much for being here. It has been a pleasure working with you in the recent past, and I look forward to working with you more in the future. Let's bring a Constitution Protection Zone to Santa Cruz, both in the city and the county. So thank you
very much. Thank you.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for watching this edition of Human Rights Here Now, and thanks to our producer, Matilda Rand, all the folks behind the cameras in the engineering room. This is how CTV works. This is what makes it work. We're all volunteers. So thank you for tuning in, and we'll see you next time on Human Rights Here Now.
The trouble at the bottom. Some say the trouble's the anatomy. Some say the trouble's in the head. Some say the trouble's the psychology. Where's the trouble at the bottom? Trouble, trouble, where's the trouble?